I still want you to look into that carry permit for me.
Top secret.
Convicted of murder.
It could change him in ways we can't imagine.
Faced with a choice.
You can either submit to a medical experiment vital to the security and interests of the United States, or we can conclude your execution.
His life is in their hands.
We intend to inject you with genetic material.
Of what?
Of extraterrestrial origin.
The transgenic nightmare has only just begun.
I'm not ready to cage, I'm a human being!
The Outer Limits, Sunday at 9:20, BBC Two.
A sleepy town in Pennsylvania turns into a seemingly irrational bloodbath of murder. Another chilling tale from The X-Files on BBC One in 10 minutes. Viewers in Wales and Northern Ireland can see that at 11 o'clock.
He had a public reputation as a towering genius. But what of Bertrand Russell, the family man?
I'm so tired of people telling me what a wonderful man Russell was. Everybody who I knew as family wound up either crazy or dead.
Meanwhile, as a humanitarian, his work continued.
If we are to live together, we must learn a kind of tolerance which is vital to human life on this planet.
And as for his sex life?
A woman accused me of being lewd, lecherous, lascivious, obscene, and aphrodisiac.
Reputations continues tomorrow at 9 on BBC Two.
Newsnight in a few minutes. First on BBC Two, another personal view from Video Nation.
You know, these road protesters and these tree protesters, well, I think they've got to point me, right, because we're just digging up too much of our countryside. It's just... We're just, like, we're not thinking ahead enough. I can see me becoming the next Swampy. You know, I really do think that slowly I'm changing, and I'm changing into one of them sort of people, you know. People who really care, you know. Because they say it's a shit world, this. And it is. But, you know, there's loads of bad people in it. But there's some good ones. And I won't be one of them people who's a good un, you know. But I don't want to be a do-gooder. I'm not a do-gooder. You know. It's like tunnelling underground and then saying, come and get me. Yes, you know what I mean? They must have balls. All them people. They must have something. You know. I think they might have something that we'd all wish that we had. You know. Because, I mean, they're not bothered about being super safe. You know what I mean? And squeaky clean.
A
came down here for the weekend, piss up. You know, just basically come down here, get drunk for the weekend, and go home on the Sunday. Well, I went home on the Sunday, cashed my gyro, and came straight back because I loved it so much. It's mainly the people and the lifestyle. I mean, you want to be in a fluffy environment, like, you know, it's great. Everyone's, like, really friendly, sharing everything, like, you know, it's really good environment. I've just come out of the cells, got arrested for staying in my tree house. Tried to nail me here to the tree, which is pretty mad. Nailed the trapdoor down, took me piercing out, tried to nail me here through the trapdoor, couldn't do it, like, so I nailed it down anyway. And told everyone that my ear is nailed to the ground, you know, just to say, you know, keep me up there for a bit longer and that. It's just a beautiful area, like, you know, it's a beautiful piece of woodland and that. It shouldn't be destroyed. So it's totally changed my point of view on that particular protest. So now it's just like, you know, totally dedicated to the protest from that day on. And I'm being back home since.
Are you sick and tired of seeing films full of men and women wearing stupid wigs? I am.
I'm sick of polite, pretty pictures full of nice dialogue that say nothing about real life.
I want to watch films full of passion,
grunge,
horror,
and mayhem.
Films that shake you up and remind you how brilliant and awful
life really is. So watch Movie Drome with me, Mark Cousins, and see real movies that strip away the lies.
A new series of Movie Drome starts Sunday, 10:05, BBC Two.
The emphasis is on chat and relaxation for BBC Two in 45 minutes as Ruby settles back with, amongst others, Rupert Everett and Fiona Shaw. Now on BBC Two, Newsnight.
What seemed like carelessness in the first few days that it was in office has now turned into a habit of overweening arrogance.
As the Tories splutter and fume, is this just the beginning? Will Labour use its massive mandate to cut a swathe through the Commons?
Good evening. There was more than a touch of the Yabu style of politics we know of old today when Labour chopped off the referendum debate. Add to that the rash of political appointments at the top and demands for Trappist-like silence by ministers unless authorised, and are we witnessing the unrolling of the Mandelson grand plan for government? Labour's minister without portfolio takes issue with Peter Lilly's view that this is an abuse of power. Also tonight has the apparent humiliation of the German government at the hands of the Bundesbank effectively signals the single currency will not happen in 1999. And is saying sorry a sign of the end of the century? After Tony Blair atones for Ireland's great famine, are we witnessing the need to exorcise past misdeeds? One historian argues you can never apologise too often for past misdemeanours. Another, that saying sorry is just self-indulgent. And Swan Lake Busby Barclay style. As the crowds and Diana flock to see it, the critics rip English National Ballet's new production apart. Is this ballet light? The show's promoter, Raymond Gubby, says it's bringing dance to the people. A dance critic argues it's just a dumbing down of the classics. First, though, the guillotine fell on the referendum debate this evening amidst indignation and cries of foul from the Tory benches. The massed ranks of New Labour in the Commons gave a whopping 266-vote majority to the bill, which will limit time for the debate of the devolution referendums in Scotland and Wales. That smack of firm government follows criticism that Labour's politicising Whitehall by installing key members of the party machine in senior government posts. Mark Mardell now asks, is the psychology of the new government that of the control freak?
Is power draining away from the Commons? has the Prime Minister's landslide victory led him into arrogance and executive contempt for a legislature that's powerless to oppose his will? The Tories certainly think so. The breaking point was the decision to curtail debate on the bill to introduce a referendum on devolution.
That it is indeed a bill which should be treated in a proper manner, not in this Stalinist dictatorship manner, which is being put through by the opposition, having regard to the fact that they are determined to have their own way at all costs, and that it is a disgrace that this bill should have been given the guillotine.
Michael Howard's rather wittier point of dictatorial comparison was Robespierre, guillotines and all that. But he, like many Conservatives, doesn't think it's a joke. They argue in one short month, Labour has ripped up the constitutional conventions.
The government has already demonstrated its contempt for Parliament. Disregard for this House runs like a thread through its actions. The cutting down of Prime Minister's questions to once a week, the Chancellor of the Exchequer's failure to announce his changes to the Bank of England to this House, and in the government's legislative programme itself. Taken together, the proposals in the Queen's speech amount to a massive transfer of powers away from this House, to bankers, to judges, to devolved assemblies, to Brussels bureaucrats. Never has there been so comprehensive an assault on the sovereignty of this House, and more importantly, on the sovereignty of those who send us to this place.
Labour argue this cutting short of a debate is nothing special. Their concerned Conservative Lords will try to hold up the bill, and they weren't going to let Tory MPs string out a simple debate with silly amendments about Cornish parliaments and voting during daylight.
So we really cannot have the kind of myth perpetrated that this has never been done before and it is some sort of new jungle territory into which we are plunging, where democracy will die among the snakes.
Some of the things it's done could have been done better. It might be excusable. It's a new government, no real experience of government. But it does have to be careful. And the more the Parliament proceeds, I think the more careful it's got to be, because MPs are less likely to take this as something they're prepared to accept.
Others are concerned at a brain drain. The dynamos who drove Labour's election campaign from the Millbank Towers headquarters are now in power in Whitehall. Charlie Whelan, Gordon Brown's spin doctor, is among the most influential of the Labour apparatchiks who've moved into Whitehall as special advisers. Some are spin doctors, some policy wonks. There are only a handful more than the Tories they replace, but the former Prime Minister finds it worrying.
He's appointed far more people in under a month than we had over an 18-year period. I think it's a mistake. I think many people will be concerned that this is leading towards politicisation of the civil service. We just wait and see how it works out.
It was Harold Wilson who first introduced special advisers, firstly only for the most senior cabinet ministers. But the idea of politically committed people paid almost to shadow civil servants caught on. Under Margaret Thatcher, all cabinet ministers had their own advisers. By John Major's time, most had a couple, one to concentrate on politics, another on policy. Today, there are five in the Treasury alone.
It's better for the government to bring in its own political people than for it actually to politicise the civil service. What was said about Mrs. Thatcher was that she applied the test on are they one of us to the civil servants themselves, and that was very confusing to a service which traditionally was politically neutral.
Sir Bernard Ingham rejects that. As Mrs. Thatcher's press secretary, he was a civil servant but no shrinking varlet. Even Tory cabinet ministers accused him of doing his mistress's bidding with too great a political enthusiasm.
I worked in exactly the same way for Labour ministers that I worked for as I did for Tory ministers. And frankly, I have some contempt for those people, those old greybeards in the civil service, who say that it is the duty and responsibility of a pucker civil servant to withhold the last ounce of commitment. I think that is a very dangerous doctrine, frankly, and could well be a form of politicisation in itself.
All this is about controlling the government machine. Labour's chief election strategist, Peter Mandelson, is now minister without portfolio. One MP, who's observed him closely over the years, claims he's the real deputy prime minister. But as a politician with a patron but no power base, his job is to be the prime minister's policy enforcer.
In opposition, Labour drew lessons both from its own past and from the Tory government, that disunity, bickering and divisions are deadly. New Labour meant new self-control. In government, that iron discipline hasn't slackened at all. Downing Street sources dismiss as garbage suggestions that the civil service is being politicised, but glory in the fact that Mr Blair wants to, as they put it, bolster the centre.
Does this mean that power is draining from civil servants in Whitehall to political appointees based at Number 10? The biggest influx of political staff under Mr Blair has been into Number 10. There are 10 more appointments than under the Tories. But there's a significant change too. Tony Blair's chief press officer, Alistair Campbell, a former Mirror journalist, has been given new powers so he can tell civil servants what to do. So has Jonathan Powell, Mr Blair's chief of staff. He'll take over many of the jobs traditionally done by the Prime Minister's top civil servant. All roads lead to Number 10.